Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We want to welcome you to the service of South Swansea Baptist Church this morning. And let me just start out by saying, first and foremost, Happy Resurrection Day. Amen. Well, we are so glad that you're here this morning, and especially I love the fact that we're all together. So take a peek, take a look around and see some of the brothers and sisters that come to the other services that maybe you don't always get to see. And so we are so grateful that the Lord's allowed us to be here in one room, gathered together on this Resurrection Day. And so let's begin with our service this morning. A welcome to each of you. We're glad you're here. To anybody visiting with us for the first time, we welcome you as our guest. We are grateful that you're here today, and we thank the Lord for you. We pray that you receive a blessing today as we go on with our service, and as you hear the preaching from the Word of God, it'll be a blessing to your heart. So shall we stand together, please, as I draw your attention to the screen for our opening hymn this morning, Agnus Dei, King of Kings.
Praise the Father.
This time, let's remain standing for prayer. Brother Keith Baker, would you come forward to the platform, please, and open our service in prayer, if you would.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus, especially on this day. We thank you for everybody here, Lord. We ask for a blessing on everybody that's been here, as it is here. We ask for a blessing on your message today, Lord. And as we hear your message and your praises today, let us always be reminded that in order for us to believe, in order for us to be a Christian, we have to believe in a risen Savior. Amen. And my hope and my prayer today is if there's anyone here that doesn't know Jesus on a personal level, if you don't know who our risen Savior is, we ask that they come forward today. See one of us. Listen to the message. We will take the time with them, Lord. We pray that you open up their heart and let them come to us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Keith.
Let's read our scripture together, Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 7. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said amongst themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he said unto them, Be not affrighted, ye see Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee.
There shall you see him, as he said unto you.
Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Let's take a moment and greet one another in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Greetings, greetings. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Resurrection Day. I'm glad to see some beautiful faces out and about here this morning, enjoying the fellowship we had downstairs as well as up here. So I pray you're blessed. I pray for those who are visiting for the first time, those who haven't visited in a while, and your family brought you back to enjoy our service. Thank you for coming. I hope you're blessed this morning. We don't have any announcements this morning, so you don't have to follow along in your bulletin, but I just want to read something from Stephen Flo Kozatek. As you know, Flo's been going through her battle with cancer, and we just wanted to pray for her and Steve. Obviously, Steve has been by her side and sacrificing his own health to make sure she's okay. So they just wanted to just send a card to the church and say thank you. They said, "The Lord bless you at Easter. It's a holy season of remembrance when God's love and amazing grace forever changed the world. Christ has triumphed and he has risen indeed." Amen. Then a personal letter from them, just real quick. It says, "To our beloved church family, we miss you dearly. We want to wish all of you a blessed Resurrection Day. We thank you for all the prayers, the cards, and encouragement. With all our love, Steve and Flo." And then, Steve had a verse that he wanted us to read, Psalm 2:12. "But what joy for all those who take refuge in him." Amen. So we miss Steve. I miss Steve downstairs because he usually makes the coffee for me. So today I was kind of like double duty. But I miss my brother down there. But we pray for Flo, most importantly, and obviously Steve as well. And we just thank them, and we miss them very much. So we thank you guys for all the prayers, the cards, and like you said, the encouragement and the phone calls. I'm pretty sure many of you have called them and checked on them, visited them. So I'm pretty sure they're very thankful for that. Also, this morning, there's an Easter offering either here in the front of this table or in the back that we're going to be taking. It's not at the in front of your pew or your seat. So if you're interested in giving today for Resurrection Sunday, the ministry that we're supporting this Sunday is Samaritan's Purse. And I just want to read real quickly here. "Every year we receive a special Easter offering. This year our offering has been designated by the church trustees to be used in conjunction with Samaritan's Purse, which is a ministry led by Franklin Graham. It is our desire to help them serve those living in Israel who have lost their homes, family members, and as Israel was invaded, as you guys know, on October 7th of last year. Samaritan's Purse has been there since the 10th, 3 days after, and support and full operation while they are there. God's word says he will bless those who bless his people, Genesis 12:3. God also tells us, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, Psalm 122:6. Will you please pray today and ask God if he's putting on your heart to give for the people of Israel that they were attacked by Hamas on October 7th, and it'll be given to Samaritan's Purse, who's been there, like I mentioned, since the 10th. They were on the ground in full operation in that ministry, helping out the people in Israel. So if you remember, just keep in mind it's here in the front. It's there in the back. As you walk out, feel free. You know, whatever God has put on your heart, that's between you and God and no one else. So I'm just going to close with the Easter offering prayer. And I believe we have another song, and I believe Pam is also singing as well. Dear Lord, we just thank you once again, Lord, for this day, Lord. Because he sacrificed his life, Lord, he lives so that we may live in him, Lord. And we thank you for his life. We thank you for the sacrifice that Christ did, Lord. Help us not to be reminded that Easter is just a once-a-year thing, Lord, but to be reminded always that the sacrifice that Christ has done for us, that we may live, that we have a place that we can call home. Lord, I just ask you to bless our brothers and sisters that are here today, those who were invited, those who are visiting for the first time, that they be blessed, Lord, and that the loved ones that brought them here today know that they want the best for them in their lives, and that's for them to walk with Christ. So, Lord, I just ask you to just bless our offering this morning, whatever you laid upon our hearts, Lord. And it's a blessing. We thank you. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Shall we stand together, please, as we sing?
My Jesus, I love.
Well, again, it's wonderful to see you here this morning, and we pray the Lord's blessing be upon each of us as we continue our time of worship together before Him. If you have your Bible with you this morning, or maybe you can grab a Bible from the pew in front of you, if you would turn to the book of Mark, Mark chapter number 16. If you do not have a Bible, just to also remind you that inside our bulletin there are the verses written out for you as well. I know I like to open my Bible because I like to mark it and take notes and underline and so forth. Let's pray together. Gracious Father in heaven, we thank you for our Lord Jesus. We rejoice in the fact that we're able to meet in the Lord's house on the Lord's day with the Lord's people. Our mind went back just a few days ago as we read scripture and went over the account of the crucifixion of Jesus. As we thought about his death on the cross and why he died and his shed blood. As we thought about those disciples who fled the scene. Many went into hiding. And there was a fear over them. We're mindful this morning as we saw the sunrise come up. And we began thinking about the account of the resurrection of Jesus. That resurrection that would overcome the fear of the disciples. That resurrection that would help to strengthen and encourage the hearts of believers. That resurrection had pointed to the fact that not only did Jesus die on the cross for our sin, for without the shedding of blood, the book of Hebrews reminds us there's no remission of sin. His resurrection indicated for all and us today, it's the reminder of how he conquered both sin and the grave. And for all who've put their faith and trust in him, because he lives, the Bible tells us, we shall live also. Father God, we're grateful. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for our brothers and sisters in Christ that we can come together with today and rejoice in our hearts together. And now in these next few moments, speak to us from your word. Do whatever needs to be done in our lives, in our hearts, to help us to be more like him. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, in Mark's account of the resurrection, by the way, that was our scripture reading this morning, the passage we've asked you to turn to, the passage has been printed into your bulletins today. Mark's account of the resurrection of Jesus includes for us two small, stirring words. He begins by telling about the women who came to the tomb to anoint the body of our Lord Jesus for burial. And to their amazement, they found the tomb empty. And an angelic being at the tomb who announced the resurrection of Jesus. He tells them, he is risen. He is not here. And then he says, but go tell the disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him as he said to you. Mark chapter 16, verse 7. when we read that on the screen, when we just read it now, what you saw and what you heard, there are two words especially there that just draw us right into this account. I'd never noticed it before. I've read this many times. I don't know if you've noticed it before, as you've read it many times. But listen. Go tell his disciples and Peter. In a very real sense, here is the result of the gospel of Jesus in two words. And Peter. Now, why is it, do you think, that we find this insertion, and Peter, in the middle of the angel's message? We might expect words of antagonism. What do you mean? Go and tell his disciples and Pontius Pilate. Or go and tell his disciples and Herod. Or go and tell his disciples and the Pharisees. Those who were involved in the indictment and the conviction of our Lord Jesus. We might expect words of appreciation. Go tell the disciples and John. John the Beloved. Why John? Because John was the one who remained at the cross with the mother of Jesus. John was the one who was at the cross with certain other women when all others had fled. In this same tone of appreciation, the angel could have added the names of Nicodemus or Joseph of Arimathea or Andrew or any number of others who had a part in a relationship to Jesus. But these were not words of antagonism. They're not words of appreciation. But I'll submit to you today that these are words of affection. Affection. For our Lord Jesus knew Peter's heart. Now, what are you saying? You remember Peter's denial in his hour of testing. We're in the book of Luke chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. If you were to go to the book of Luke, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and chapter 14 in your Bible, in Luke 14, now, you know what I did? I just had you turn to Luke 14. Yeah. What I wanted you to do is turn to Mark 14. I'm getting your fingers acquainted with your Bible this morning. In Mark chapter 14, always make one mistake. It encourages those who don't try. In 14 verse 27, then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter said to him, even if all are made to stumble, yet I will not be. Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that today, even this night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. But he, Peter, spoke more vehemently, if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And they all said likewise. Now look at verse 66. Same chapter. Mark. Chapter 16. 14. There again. Verse 66. You're making sure I'm on here today. Now as Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servants of the high priest came. And when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "You also were with Jesus of Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you are saying." And he went out on the porch, and a rooster crowed. And the servant girl saw him again and began to say to those who stood by, "This is one of them." But he denied it again. And a little later, those who stood by said to Peter again, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean, and your speech shows it." Then he began to curse and swear, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." A second time, the rooster crowed. Then Peter called to mind the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And when he thought about it, he went and wept. See, our Lord Jesus knew Peter's heart. After Peter's denial during his hour of testing, Jesus knows Peter's in need of an empty tomb message. Jesus knows that Peter is in need of a word of encouragement. Jesus knows that Peter's in need of a new beginning. Jesus knows that Peter is in need of a second chance. And so four things we mentioned to you quickly and we're done. Number one, the empty tomb of Jesus shows us that a second chance is possible. The empty tomb of Jesus shows us that a second chance is possible. In 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, and I won't have you go all over the Bible for this one, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 12, Paul's writing to the church at Corinth, and Paul says this, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen or died in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man, that's the man Christ Jesus, also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive." The resurrection of Jesus. So Paul makes the argument in the Corinthian letter that without the resurrection, there'd be no gospel. Without the resurrection, there'd be no good news. Without the resurrection, there would be no hope of a second chance. Yet the Bible is full. The record in the Word of God is full of both men and women who received a second chance to deliver a nation. Who of us would have picked one who had committed murder? And yet there's a gentleman by the name of Moses who spent 40 years on the backside of the desert in preparation for him to be the emancipator of his people out of Egypt. And when the Lord spoke to him from a burning bush, Moses knew a second chance was possible through him. You might recall with me the Old Testament leader overcome by his sinful desire. Who of us would have ever thought that a guy like that would be sought out by God to become a man after God's own heart? And when we read of King David's prayer of repentance in Psalm 51, we see that a second chance is possible. What about Jonah? Jonah was given a call from God. He was put on mission. We know his story. We remember the Bible says in Jonah 3:1 how the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. Do you know what that's called? That's called a second chance. There was also in the New Testament scripture, there's that one, you know the name, Saul of Tarsus, who was a persecutor of believers, made havoc of the church. He sought to not only capture believers, but to destroy their lives, take their lives. And that is until he has the letters and he's on his way en route to Damascus in Acts chapter 9. And the Lord knocks him with the bright light off his horse. And he responds, Lord, what will you have me to do? Because it was Jesus who was giving him another chance. A second chance is possible. Aren't you grateful for second chances? And sometimes they're third and fourth. More. But I do want to hasten to say this. A second chance is possible, but before you believe it to be an automatic given, there's another person in the Bible. His name is Judas. He betrayed Jesus. He didn't get it. He didn't get the second chance. You see, Judas reformed, but he didn't repent. The rich young ruler, remember him in the Gospels? He didn't get it. The rich young ruler was remorseful, yet he went away sorrowful with no record in the Bible of ever having repented of his sin. You know, we all know Pontius Pilate. We mentioned him moments ago. He did not get it. Oh, yes, he regretted his evil deed at the trial of Jesus. In fact, we have that picture. He even got a basin and washed his hands of it all and dried his hands and said, I'm done. But the washing of hands, he knew nothing of repentance. He didn't get it. So second chance. You're mentioning that God gives us a second chance, and he does. But this is for men and women who, like Peter, recognize their sin and turn from their sin. Amen. Isn't that the difference? Secondly, the empty tomb shows us not only that a second chance is possible, but that a second chance is personal. Now, what do you mean by that? What I mean by that is that the love of Jesus singles you out. You're singled out today. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You're part of this world. So for God so loved you, sir. God so loved you, ma'am. God so loved you, young person. He singles you out. In John chapter 10, verse 3, you might remember this. Jesus, the Bible reminds us, calls his own sheep by name. Which means he knows you. Which means it's a personal message. I find it very interesting in our text how the angel used at the tomb, the angel used his new name. The angel did not say, go and tell the disciples and Simon. That was his old name. Now, some might have expected the message to be, go and tell the disciples and Simon his old name. Why? Because he had been living under his old nature. Think about that. He denied Jesus. He cussed at Jesus. He swore about Jesus. But it's interesting to me in our text that the Bible doesn't say, go and tell the disciples and Simon. No, he said, Jesus said, the angel spoke, go and tell Peter that Jesus is risen. Now put yourself in Peter's place. Can you do that for a moment? I've already shared with you there are times as I read the Word of God, I like to see the sights and smell the smells and feel the wind on my face. I like to get immersed in the account. So let's do that. Put yourself in Peter's place. Peter failed terribly. Wouldn't you say so? Peter failed terribly. But you know what's amazing to me? And it's just like our great God. That in spite of Peter's failure, Jesus, according to our text, believed in Peter still. You see, that's really important, right? Because in relationship to, we come to, we believe in, we trust in, we seek to know Jesus. Amen? Through the relationship that we have with him. But what's interesting to me here, the affirmation that Jesus makes concerning Peter. In other words, in relationship to, we believe in Jesus. To know Jesus believes in us. What affirmation that is. For you and me to be known as one of the children of the King. For you and me to be known as one of God's kids. That's huge. The empty tomb shows that a second chance is not only possible, but it's also personal. So what is the message? What is the message? The message here that is personal concerning this empty tomb is that God seeks you. I'm so glad he does. I'm glad he sought me. I'm glad he sought me when I didn't want to be sought. The message is personal. God not only seeks you, but God cares about you. There's not another person on planet Earth that cares as much about you as Almighty God. Amen. And he not only cares about you, but we said it moments ago, but I want it to permeate your heart, your life. I want it to, the message to sink in. God not only seeks you, God not only cares about you, but God loves you. He loves you. Sin does a lot of things, doesn't it? Sin does a lot of things. It ruins hearts. It wrecks homes. It spoils plans. It seeks to destroy people's lives. But sin cannot make God stop loving you. Amen. You remember Romans chapter 5 when Paul's writing to the church at Rome? In Romans chapter 5, to remind them then and to remind us this morning, Paul writes, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And I've said this so many times, but I'm going to say it again. God never said to us, clean it up first, and here I come. No, friend, you and I would still be trying to clean it. We'd still be trying to clean it. And we'd fail terribly. What I'm saying is, the empty tomb of Jesus shows us a second chance is possible. The empty tomb of Jesus shows us that a second chance is personal. The empty tomb of Jesus, thirdly, shows us a second chance is private. Now, what do I mean? There's an amazing verse in 1 Corinthians 15. When Jesus rose from the grave, the Bible says in 15:5 of 1 Corinthians, he was seen by Cephas. Cephas is Peter's name in Aramaic, and it means rock. So he says, the Bible says, he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. I want you to consider this with me for a moment as we look at all the accounts, as you consider all the accounts of the resurrection of Jesus, and that is that when Jesus came out of the tomb, one of the first things he did was to find Peter. Think about that. Think about that. Why would he do that? Why would he decide, yes, I want to connect with the disciples, but before I do this, and Peter, I want to see Peter. Because there's something in the message of the resurrection and the empty tomb, the tomb being empty, that teaches us about a second chance.
Amen.
And it's something for everybody. It's possible, it's personal, but it's also private. Now, we know that there are some things that are so personal and so private, and some things the Bible speaks about as a mystery that God does not record them for us in the canon. We'll know one day when we are known even as he is. Amen?
Amen.
But I'm sure Peter thought when Jesus was seeking him out, and Peter, I'm sure Peter thought he was finished. But yet Jesus sought him and found him privately. It wasn't a big production. It wasn't, well, let's get everybody together and then let me speak. No, no. It was before them, let me see Peter. And what took place in their meeting? Do you know? I don't know. Perhaps it's one of those things that God, in his infinite wisdom, has decided not to reveal to us. But I can think about this in my mind. What took place in that meeting? I don't know. Perhaps tears were shed. Perhaps broken sentences were given. Perhaps there were deep sobs or long breaks of silence. What we do know is it's another demonstration to us of the kind-heartedness of our Lord Jesus Christ. He meets with Peter before seeing him at the 12, and though Peter denied him publicly, Jesus forgives him privately. I'm so thankful for the forgiveness of God. How about you? Every day. We come before the Father and say, Father, forgive me for. There's the sins of commission. The sins that we commit. We know they're sins. We shouldn't do them. Sometimes we do them. But God doesn't leave it like that. We have the opportunity to come before him who is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Sometimes there's the sins of omission. Those things we know we should do. Those things that we want to bless somebody with and we don't do them. Therefore, to him that knoweth doeth good and doeth it not, to him it is, according to James. I think of the kind-heartedness of Jesus when he comes to Peter. I told you four things. The empty tomb of Jesus shows us that a second chance is possible. The empty tomb of Jesus shows us that a second chance is personal. The empty tomb of Jesus shows us that the second chance is private. And fourthly, the empty tomb of Jesus shows us a second chance is profitable. Now, I don't want to confuse you. I'm not saying profitable as in filling your billfold or your bank account. That's not what I'm referring to here. There's other ways that are profitable. What I'm referring to is that whatever took place between Peter and Jesus, their meeting transformed Peter's life. Peter was seen at a time of testing where he denied Jesus three times. Peter is seen going out and weeping bitterly. Jesus and Peter meet, and after that meeting, whether that meeting involved tears or broken sentences or quivering lips or deep sobs or long breaks of silence, whatever took place at that meeting, the empty tomb of Jesus shows us that the second chance is profitable, because now after Peter meets with Jesus, it transforms his life, and we see Peter now at Pentecost preaching to thousands of people, seeing thousands of people give their hearts and lives to Jesus. We see Peter now in a position where he becomes a leader in the early church. We see Peter throughout the book of Acts. In fact, Peter's key statement, the Bible says of Peter that he cannot help but speak the things he's seen and heard. And all the way through the book of Acts, we see that message. And in the two books that bear his name, 1 Peter and 2 Peter, he does exactly that. He speaks and he teaches and he preaches those things that he saw and those things that he heard in relation to the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? We see Peter, we see him beaten. We see him imprisoned. We see him going through it all, counting it worthy to suffer for Christ's name. And we rejoice in that. But isn't it true? Sometimes we have a way of remembering one's failures and forgetting their strong points. Oh, you should see God is using. Yeah, but do you remember what they did? Do you really know who they are? I don't know. Maybe I'm off point on this. You can tell me someday. 20 years from now. If some churches today have been chosen to give the angel's message, they might have said, go and tell the disciples, but forget Peter. He's a failure. But Peter's a failure? Don't you remember he tried to walk on water and he couldn't do it? Yeah, he's a failure. But don't you remember he denied Jesus? Swore? Cussed? Yep. Go and tell the disciples, but forget Peter. We can't forget Peter. Listen to the message of the angel again. He says, go and tell the disciples and Peter that he has gone before you into Galilee. In Jesus' resurrection, beloved, listen. And this demonstrates it for us. The message of the Bible. In Jesus' resurrection, there is forgiveness for sin. Amen. Peter experienced it. I've experienced it. You've experienced it. In Jesus' resurrection, we are empowered by his Spirit to have victory over our failures. Peter experienced it. Amen. I've experienced it. You've experienced it. In the resurrection of Jesus, there is a second chance. Peter experienced it. I've experienced it. You've experienced it. Simon Peter remained faithful unto death. Before Peter died, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 and 14, we have to inject this. Before Peter died, he wrote, under inspiration of God, "Yes, I think it is right, as long as I am in this tent, this body, this earthly body, to stir you up by reminding you, knowing that shortly I must put off my tent, just as our Lord Jesus Christ showed me." You ever read that verse? You ever think about it? Study it through a little bit? Was Peter remembering an early breakfast on the shore, where three times Jesus gave him the opportunity to affirm his love? "Peter, do you love me? Yes, I do. Feed my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Yes, I do. Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? You know I love you, Lord. Feed my lambs." And then Jesus concluded their conversation by saying to Peter in John 21, 18 and 19, "When you are old, Peter, another will stretch out your hands and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish." This Jesus spoke, signifying by what death Peter would glorify God. And when Jesus had spoken this, he said to Peter, "Follow me." I don't know how many times you've read that. How many times we've delved into that account. But it hit me in preparation for today. It is not enough to know that a second chance is possible. It's not enough to know that a second chance is personal. It's not enough to know that a second chance is private. It's not enough to know that a second chance is profitable. The real hope of a second chance is in obeying Jesus' words, "Follow me." The Lord Jesus told a story about another second chance in Luke's gospel. It's a story of a young man for whom things had become too dull at home. The bright lights of the big city held a fascination for him, so he took his inheritance and he left. He thought he was going to find a good time. But what he really found were hangovers and ripoffs and unemployment lines. And finally, while in the employ of keeping the pig pen, he rehearsed a speech how he would go home and simply applied for a job as one of his father's hired servants. When he was returning home, his father saw him coming afar off. His father ran off the porch to meet him, and they stopped. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son." Dad didn't poke a finger in his chest. Dad didn't clench a fist in front of his face. Dad didn't cross his arms while sighing in disgust. Dad didn't scold him while sternly asking, "Where have you been?" No. No, sir. No, ma'am. His dad hugged him tight. And his dad forgave him. Amen. And his dad welcomed him home. What a picture of God the Father loving on and embracing each of us today. You see, one day Jesus, with his arms stretched open wide, died on a cross for our sin. Your sin and mine. The sins of the whole world. He was buried and rose again the third day, conquering both death and the grave, and all who come to him by grace through faith receive forgiveness of sin in a home in heaven. So let me ask you in conclusion, is there anyone here who has failed? Is there anyone here who has failed? Many of us were lost in sin. Beloved, some of you still are. Listen to these words one final time. Go and tell the disciples and Peter that he, Jesus, has risen and gone before you into Galilee. You know, poet Louisa Fletcher gives us this perspective in her poem. It's a poem entitled The Land of Beginning Again. She wrote, I wish that there were some wonderful place in the land of beginning again where all our mistakes and all our heartaches and all of our poor selfish grief could be dropped like a shabby old coat at the door and never put on again. Thank God there is such a place. Amen?
Amen.
It's a walk by faith. It starts at the cross. And by the grace of God, it's brought home to our heart by the resurrection of Jesus Christ and that empty tomb. You see, 2 Corinthians 5, verses 15 and 17 say this, and he, that's Jesus, died for all, so that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new.
Amen.
Shall we pray? Just before Pam comes and sings the closing number for us. Is this a message you can relate to today? It certainly is one that I can. It makes my heart so well up in gratitude for Jesus and all that he's done. Maybe there's somebody here this morning. You have yet to put faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. That one who died for your sin, was buried, and rose again the third day, just as he said, conquering both death and the grave for you. The scripture reminds us in the 10th chapter of the book of Romans. Once again, Paul is writing to the church at Rome. And he's writing in chapter 10 concerning the relationship to Jesus. And Paul writes that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Before Pam comes and sings this morning, if you've never trusted Christ, let me encourage you to do that today. Know for sure your sin forgiven and heaven your home. You say, preacher, how do I do that? It's simple prayer. It's a heart belief and simple prayer. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so there it is. Will you call upon Jesus this morning? Maybe you can pray something like this, or in your own words. Lord God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Thank you, God, for sending your Son Jesus to die on the cross for my sin. Forgive me my sin and save my soul. And right here and now, by faith, I ask Jesus Christ to come into my life and to save me. If that's you this morning, and you've admitted that you're a sinner, that can't save yourself, you need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved, and you've confessed your sin unto him, then welcome to God's family. Tell somebody, I ask Jesus to come in my life today, and let him begin through his word to take you on a wonderful journey through the personal relationship you have with him. In Jesus' name. Pam, come sing for us.
If you take your bulletins, on the back are these words. And I hope you sing these words with me, because this is the anthem of a Christian. We can stand. We stand in the power of Jesus, not in our own. And if Jesus is all that you have, then you have all that you need. Amen. In Christ alone, my hope is found. My light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross where Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth through glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, power of Christ I stand, here in the power of Christ.
Shall we stand together, please, as we're dismissed with prayer? Brother John Chase, would you come to the front, please, and dismiss us with God's blessing? It's been a pleasure, it's been a joy to see you this morning and to worship together with you on this Resurrection Sunday. And it's my prayer that Jesus will become that constant reality in your life. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless. Thank you.
Father, we are so grateful for the debt that you paid for us. And today we celebrate your resurrection, because without the resurrection, we would have no place to stand. It truly is Christ alone. Help us to go out different than we came in. Pray, Father, if there's someone here this morning that has brought some thoughts to their mind, they have not yet accepted you as their personal Savior. And as Pastor said this morning, it is a personal relationship. Mm-hmm. And it'll be the best decision you ever made.
Amen.
Thank you for the day. Thank you for what you've done. Help us to not just take it as just another resurrection day. Make it be an impact on our lives.